spring is in the air, and that means that lots of people come out to the American Academy, because when the air is starting to lose its bite and the Wannsee becomes a temptation again, this room is usually full. But it's not just the spring, I guess, that brings all of you here tonight, but also the combination of a topic that is just so pertinent and is keeping us all on edge to a degree that we haven't, I guess, witnessed in quite a while. And also the speaker, obviously, a speaker who is as experienced and curious and well-known and trusted and independent in his judgment as Bill Drozdiak is. And so the Hans Arnold Center, Bill, is full again, and you filled it tonight. Thanks for that, too. Thanks also to all of you for joining us on a debate on the illusion of America First, which is the title that Bill chose for this lecture. And we don't have to explain why that is an interesting title at the moment. And that is the sad part of the story. Let me welcome all of you on behalf of Michael Steinberg, the president of the American Academy, who is not here with us tonight, but he sends his warm greetings. And he will watch the proceedings, most likely on the video stream at some point later. So he's with us, and that's a good thing. My name is Jan Techo. I'm the director of the Holbrook Forum here at the American Academy. And I will be your host tonight for a lack of other personnel available. And I hope that that's something that you can swallow and stomach tonight. This event tonight is another installment of our Foreign Policy Forum, a series of lectures and discussions that we've had here for a number of years now, and which has become a bit of a mainstay of Academy work. It's great that we can continue the debate on transatlantic affairs in this framework. And it is a continuation also to a degree, and that's the astonishing part of our discussions here at the Academy about the Trump phenomenon. We have had at least four or five events over the last couple of months, maybe weeks you can even say, where we looked at various aspects of this phenomenon that we're all grappling with. Whenever we have Trump on the menu, people will order. It's quite clear that, you know, Trump, to a degree, is the gift that keeps on giving, and so we will continue doing these kinds of things. Let me also express my sincere gratitude to Daimler, the car maker, who has supported the Foreign Policy Forum for quite a number of years now and has helped us make this forum, you know, what it is now. And I would like to warmly welcome Christopher Dreke, who is here from the company and represents Daimler here tonight. Thanks a lot for coming over. Let me extend an extra warm welcome to Joschka Fischer, the former German foreign minister, who's here with us tonight, and also to Otto Schily, the former interior minister. And it's great to have you here, practitioners, you know, from what seems to be now the good old days. but from the discussion that we just had over the dining table, it's quite clear that you are as engaged as ever, and that your sharp eye is following the situation quite closely. And that's great to know. That we have some of the serious big people in the background following this. Most importantly, however, I need to welcome, of course, Bill Drozdiak. Herzlich willkommen at the Academy, an old friend of Germany, an old hand in transatlantic relations, a friend of Europe in the United States, and a personal friend, and the speaker tonight, and the Academy's chairman, Gail Burt, found out a few weeks ago that Bill is about to finish a book on Europe, and she asked him immediately, can you come and presented here at the Academy, and he chose to actually build his lecture on one of the chapters, one of the concluding chapters, and I hope that we can get as much insight and wisdom out of him on America First, on the prevailing mood, on what that means for us over here as Europe, and what can potentially be done in this transatlantic partnership to deal with it. Gail asked Bill to speak not just because he's a great analyst of current affairs and the stuff that we see right in front of us, but because he can merge his current analysis with deep insight into history, and putting it into the perspective, you know, of his profound knowledge of European and German affairs. And because he has been, over many years, not just an observer, but both a pulse giver and a pulse feeler of transatlantic affairs, of the pulse that keeps this partnership together. As most of you will know, Bill was the president of the American Council on Germany for a decade, and a foreign affairs editor and reporter with the Washington Post and other prestigious media outlets for about 20 years. In between, he helped the German Marshall Fund set up its transatlantic center in Brussels. He was a professional basketball player, which is what brought him to Europe in the first place. And perhaps most tellingly, Bill also studied at the College of Europe in Bruges, a school from which the European Union typically and traditionally recruits many of its mandarins and institutional leaders. And he opted for the College of Europe at a time when this was actually a rather unusual thing for a young American fellow to do. And it's interesting that at a very early time, Bill had the right instinct, you know, where the right Kool-Aid was to be drank. And he drank it, and the European bug got him, and he never lost it after this. Today, Bill is a non-resident scholar at the Brookings Institution, and he's also with McLarty Associates, one of the most important and most prestigious political consultancies in Washington. So he's been in many different roles over the years, but he was always, wherever he was, at the very heart of things happening. And that's great, because tonight he's here, and we'll make things happen here tonight. He will speak, give us the key insights from his book, from that concluding chapter, and then we will have the short discussion, I guess, on the panel with a few questions from my side, and then we'll hand it over to you and get the dogs off the leash and hopefully, you know, have a wonderful, lively discussion here about, you know, the affairs that keep us all up at night to a degree. Bill, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much, Jan, for those kind and welcoming words. It's a great pleasure for me to be back in Berlin to see so many old friends and to visit some old haunts. I remember exactly 20 years ago coming to this building with Richard Holbrooke when he was setting up the Academy, and we were accompanied by Anna Maria Kellen, and she took us around to each room and showed us where she played and where she had fond memories of this house when the Arnhold family was living. And so it's great to see the Academy thriving and to have so many fellows, because this was Richard's dream, to replace the 12,000 American soldiers who had been based in Berlin with a parade of intelligent, insightful, and interesting Americans who could keep the dialogue between the United States and Germany prospering in a way that I think he would be very proud of today. We all miss him, but we're happy that his spirit lives on here at the Academy. Well, for the last year and a half, I've been traveling around many parts of Europe, putting together the research that led to the writing of a book, which will come out on September 11th, very inauspicious date. It is entitled Fractured Continent, Europe's Crises and the Fate of the West, be published in the United States by W.W. Norton, and here in Europe by Aurel Fuseli in French, German, and Italian. So I think the timing of the book coming out 2 weeks before the German election, I hope it will still, its theses remain valid. But while I've noted the thrust of the book is mainly about all the changes that are afflicting Europe today, I could not leave out what is happening in the United States. And so I made the concluding chapter titled The Illusion of America First, because I think, and the purpose of this lecture is to provide what I think is a context for you to understand what is going on in the United States and how this is affecting to a very troubling degree one of the most successful partnerships in the history of the world, that is the Atlantic Alliance. So I will speak about that, then we'll take questions at the end. For seven decades, the Atlantic Alliance has provided the crucial foundation for the security and stability of Western democracies. A common pledge to defend free speech, open markets, and transparent elections cemented the bonds between the United States and the European allies throughout the Cold War and beyond. This partnership became an inspiration for the captive populations in communist societies who yearned for a life of greater personal liberty and prosperity following the collapse of the Soviet Empire. During all this time, American leadership proved essential. It sustained the cohesion of the West through the Marshall Plan and economic recovery after World War II, the creation of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization to repel the threat of a Soviet invasion of Western Europe, and the expansion of democracy once the Cold War ended. Since 1945, 12 American presidents, 6 Democrats and 6 Republicans, gave unwavering support to a transatlantic alliance that defined the United States as an indispensable nation to maintain world order. All 12 presidents fulfilled the role of commander-in-chief for a Western community of nations that looked to the United States to serve as the ultimate protector of its shared values and interests. The election of Donald Trump has called that legacy into question. Even before taking the oath of office, Trump undermined America's longstanding promise to defend its allies. He suggested the United States would only abide by Article 5 of the NATO Treaty, which commits members to treat an attack on one as an attack against all, if those countries under threat were spending enough money on their own defense. He vowed to tear up past and pending trade pacts, including the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, TTIP, which has been negotiated at German initiative over the last 4 years and was designed to revitalize Western leadership of the global economy. Even before he took over the presidency, Trump's isolationist refrain that America was no longer willing to bear the costs of acting as the guarantor of global stability and security scrambled the dynamics of world power. By insisting the time had come to think about America first, even if it meant disengaging from the world, Trump gave the impression that promises underpinning American leadership of the post-war international order would now be put on the negotiating table. During the election campaign, Trump vacillated on a number of foreign policy issues, such as whether or not he supported or opposed the Iraq war. But on relations with Europe, Trump has delivered a consistent message for nearly 2 decades. He praised the strong leadership of Russia's Vladimir Putin and described NATO as obsolete. And as early as the year 2000, when his book, The America We Deserve, first appeared, Trump disavowed intervention in Europe by claiming America has no vital interest in choosing between warring factions whose animosities go back centuries. He lamented the costs of stationing troops in Europe and said an American withdrawal could save our country millions of dollars annually. He saw no reason why the United States should be devoted to keeping the peace among nations of Europe because, quote, their conflicts are not worth American lives, unquote. In his first major foreign policy speech during the campaign, Trump made it clear that as president, he would embark on a radical new departure for America's role in the world that would no longer emphasize global commitments, but instead address America's own needs above anything else. Quote, America first will be the overriding theme of my administration, Trump said. Under a Trump administration, no American citizen will ever feel again that their needs come second to the citizens of foreign countries. My foreign policy will always put the interests of the American people and American security first. The choice of America first as Trump's mantra recalled the disastrous years of the 1930s when pro-German isolationists led by aviation hero Charles Lindbergh and other anti-Semites fought to keep the United States from entering the war to stop Nazi aggression in Europe. While Trump's message appalled historians, it resonated among many American voters who were disenchanted by the interminable wars in Iraq and Afghanistan and who wanted to see their government invest more resources to rebuild and repair their own nation. For the first time since 1945, an American president has endorsed the controversial path of nationalism and protectionism as a cure for the nation's troubles. Trump's vision, if put into practice, would jeopardize the vital role of the United States as the chief defender of the liberal democratic order. It would also erode faith in America's commitments on everything from climate change and international trade to mutual defense treaties and nuclear deterrence. Trump's message has rocked America's allies in Europe to the core. Even though populist nationalists have been on the rise across the continent for many years, fewer Europeans expected the backlash against globalization would drive Americans to elect somebody who is prepared to turn his back on 70 years of American leadership of the Western democracies. In his inaugural address, Trump reaffirmed his conviction that the time had come for America to stop bearing the heavy costs of defending foreign allies. He declared that under his presidency, the United States would narrow the focus of its global security strategy to defending the homeland against radical Islamist terrorism. His message struck fear in the hearts of many Europeans who may have become complacent in believing that the American military shield would always be available to protect them from outside threats. Now they realize the day may soon come when their principal protector could abandon them. Would this mean the end of the West as we know it? Besides questioning NATO's relevance, Trump disparaged the European Union as a faceless supranational bureaucracy that had robbed people of control of their daily lives. He saw the European Union as an economic rival rather than a partner for the United States. He praised Britain's decision to leave the EU and even endorsed Nigel Farage, a leading Eurosceptic who spearheaded the Brexit campaign, as the person he would like to see as Britain's next ambassador to Washington. And while Prime Minister Theresa May has said that is the farthest thing from her mind, last Saturday night, Donald Trump was dining with Nigel Farage in the dining room of his hotel in Washington. Like other critics, Trump overlooks the EU's extraordinary achievements, starting with peaceful reconciliation between France and Germany, which over five centuries had been fighting each other virtually every generation. The European project banished the risk of war among 28 EU member states and nurtured a degree of prosperity unmatched in the rest of the world. Yet three generations after World War II, those accomplishments are taken too much for granted by young Europeans who have known nothing but peace, free education, universal health care, and rising living standards, largely because of achievements made possible by the European Union. Those who cheered Trump's victory were mainly Europe's populist demagogues, who have been demanding that more powers be returned to the nation states, even though their ancient rivalries contributed so mightily to Europe's history of bloodshed. Geert Wilders, who heads the Freedom Party in the Netherlands and who hopes to become prime minister, perhaps even as soon as after the March 15th elections, hailed Trump's win as the start of a patriotic spring that would soon spread across Europe. He said it was only a matter of time before other populist nationalists, like himself, would achieve power and vanquish the forces of globalization, immigration, and corrupt ruling establishments. Marine Le Pen, the leader of France's far-right National Front, who hopes to achieve her goal of becoming president of France, praised Trump for liberating the American people and inspiring a great movement across the world. And Hungary's Prime Minister Viktor Orban, whose country benefits enormously from European Union subsidies, called Trump on the phone shortly after his victory and said that he hopes to get together with him soon in the White House. Trump's rise to power was also greeted by enthusiasm in Moscow, where the Duma, or National Parliament, erupted in loud applause upon hearing the news of his election victory. While dismissing reports that the Kremlin approved cyber attacks that would benefit Trump's campaign. President Putin still promised to work closely with the new president in building a cooperative relationship between Russia and the United States. The contacts that apparently occurred between the Trump campaign and the Kremlin are soon going to be under investigation in the United States, and this could have a profound effect on the relationship between Moscow and Washington. One of Trump's biggest challenges will come in reassuring Europe's leaders about American support for international agreements that were reached by the Obama administration, including on climate change in Iran. Trump has criticized the Iran nuclear accord that was reached in 2015 after years of haggling between Tehran and an international coalition, including the United States, Germany, France, Britain, Russia, and China. The deal imposes strict limits on Iran's nuclear program that is designed to prevent the building of atomic weapons in exchange for the suspension of economic sanctions. Trump and many Republicans claim that the agreement is badly flawed and have vowed to change its terms or else abandon it. They have discussed applying new sanctions on Iran for activity unrelated to its nuclear programs, including ballistic missile testing and support for terrorism in the Middle East. The new sanctions could involve having the Treasury Department demand that foreign banks stop handling transactions involving Iranian firms. That measure alone could meet with staunch resistance from our allies. Rejecting the Iran accord would have devastating consequences for American credibility. It would open the door for Iran to revive its uranium enrichment program, renew its pursuit of nuclear weapons, and provoke a damaging split with China, Russia, and our leading European allies. None of them would be willing to follow a unilateral American move and endorse fresh sanctions against Iran, particularly since they have initiated lucrative new investments there. And if Iran did renew its quest for nuclear weapons, the United States would then be left on its own, along with Israel, to take military action against Tehran. That, in turn, could trigger a new nuclear arms race in the Middle East as other countries in the region, notably Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Turkey, would be tempted to acquire their own nuclear deterrent. Trump's praise for Vladimir Putin and his choice of Exxon's chairman and chief executive Rex Tillerson as his Secretary of State suggest he is determined to make reconciliation with Russia one of his top foreign policy priorities. Given Trump's transactional style, he may be willing to turn a blind eye to Russia's annexation of Crimea and lift economic sanctions in exchange for Moscow's help in waging a more effective campaign against Islamist terrorism. But any shift in American policy toward Russia and the sanctions policy could spread disarray among the European allies. Several countries, including Italy, Bulgaria, Greece, and France, already oppose the sanctions now in effect against Russia and want to get back to business as usual with Moscow. The Baltic nations fear they might become the victims of a new Russian-American entente and be left unprotected against Moscow's aggressive designs to roll back history. Even though the Baltic states joined NATO after the collapse of the Soviet Union, they are still deeply worried that a Trump administration may not live up to the alliance's collective security pledges. Any loss of faith in America's promises could open a Pandora's box of uncontrollable consequences in Asia as well as Europe. For example, hard bargaining by a Trump administration with Japan and South Korea over a reassessment of the American security mission in Asia could push them to pursue nuclear weapons. China, meanwhile, might be encouraged to expand its military presence in the South China Sea if and when the United States pulls back. American presidents have complained for years about the persistent failure of European allies to assume a fair share of the defense burden. Only 5 countries out of NATO's 28 members, the United States, Britain, Poland, Estonia, and Greece, have lived now live up to the alliance pledge of devoting at least 2% of their national income to their defense budget. Besides doubts about whether they would come to the aid of another ally under attack, many Europeans still seem reluctant even to resort to the use of military force to defend their own homeland. A 2014 Gallup International survey showed only 29% of French citizens, 27% of British, and 18% of Germans said they were willing to fight for their country. A total of 68% of Italians said they would outright refuse to do so. Trump's frequent allusions to America First contrast sharply with the eloquent promises made by every other American president since 1945 to champion democracy, an open world trading system, and honor security commitments to the Allies. When he took office in 1961, John F. Kennedy left no doubt that the United States was prepared to defend the cause of freedom around the world. Quote, "Let every nation know," he declared, "whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe, to assure the survival and success of liberty." Kennedy's vision restored faith in American leadership of the free world at a time when a young, untested president was being challenged by a Soviet communist empire that seemed determined to take control of the entire continent. The Kennedy generation had learned through bitter experience what history taught their parents. The America First policies that sought to isolate the United States from the problems of the world during the 1920s and 1930s only aggravated the economic and military devastation resulting from the Great Depression and the Second World War. In the 21st century, the idea of that Fortress America could find shelter behind two oceans from turmoil abroad is even less true today than it was between the two world wars. The notion of an impregnable American citadel shielded from the rest of the world is particularly misguided when it comes to international economics. Trump says he wants to renegotiate the North America Free Trade Agreement, which he describes as the worst trade deal in history. He insists the deal that brought China into the World Trade Organization, which he blames for the closure of tens of thousands of American factories, must be thoroughly revised. He also intends to throw out the pending Trans-Pacific Partnership reached by the United States, Japan, and 10 other Asia-Pacific countries. Already, China is stepping into the void with its own offer of a comprehensive trade agreement with many of the same countries, which would help Beijing solidify its regional ascendancy and deprive the United States of privileged access to Asian markets. Many Republicans, including Senator John McCain, believe that Trump's withdrawal from the Trans-Pacific trade deal will backfire on American interests and accelerate China's rise as the dominant power in Asia, if not the world. With Europe, Trump says he wants to reconsider the TTIP accord, which has been under negotiation between the United States and the European Union for the past 4 years. Sometimes it's called an economic version of NATO. The TTIP is designed to fortify the Western alliance by reducing regulatory barriers to the enormous volumes of trade investment across the Atlantic, which still account for nearly half of all global economic activity. Perhaps more important, TTIP would ensure the rules established by the United States and Europe would become the gold standard for world trade, reinforcing Western leadership of the global economy at a time when many people worry the United States is retreating from its responsibilities abroad. Trump and his followers may think the best way to advance the interests of American workers and consumers would be to trash existing multinational trade agreements and cut separate deals with individual countries. The new president has said repeatedly that he believes the United States can curtail its dependence on other governments by imposing high trade barriers that will ensure that Americans buy products made at home. Yet as the world discovered in the 1930s, nothing could be further from the truth. In today's global economy, fewer products than ever before in human history are made in one place. More than half the goods and nearly three quarters of the services traded on a global basis include components from different countries. Even the most powerful nation in the world needs the cooperation of other governments in managing trade. American automobile, computer, and pharmaceutical companies are so deeply integrated in global supply chains that any moves toward national autonomy would disrupt industries that employ millions of Americans and impose staggering costs on American consumers. Trump's rejection of these trade agreements would only invite retaliation from China and other major trading partners. The world's open trade and investment system has depended to a great extent on the United States in order to function smoothly. If the principal sponsor starts acting in a unilateral way to change the terms of the contract, there are many other players who would be happy to respond in kind. For example, when Trump spoke about the prospect of 45% tariffs being slapped on Chinese exports, Beijing was quick to remind him that such acts of hostility might affect their willingness to maintain enormous holdings of American debt. At a time when populist nationalism is growing in many parts of the world and not just in the United States, the risks of retaliatory economic warfare in the guise of protectionism have become ever more apparent. If America decides to break the rules on its own, it could easily unleash the kind of economic catastrophe that led to the Great Depression. The volume of world trade today is already shrinking, and according to some measurements, now hovers at levels no greater than two decades ago. A revival of protectionism could be a dangerous impulse that drives the global economy into a deep recession. After all, the decisive blow that ushered in the Great Depression of the 1930s came when the Smoot-Hawley tariffs were approved by an isolationist-minded Congress. The United States has been seduced by the siren song of isolationism in the past, yet the desire to wall itself off from foreign turmoil always ended in tragedy. We must remind ourselves, the America First movement emerged in the aftermath of World War I, when the senseless carnage caused by trench warfare and toxic gas convinced many of Americans that they should never again become entangled in foreign conflicts. The painful sacrifice of 50,000 American lives in just the last 19 months of Europe's Great War, which was supposedly a noble crusade to make the Western world safe for democracy, appalled the entire country and infused strong anti-war sentiments among voters and the US Congress. In the wake of that horrible war, Americans decided their country should never again become drawn into the precarious balance of power battles in Europe that many believed had very little to do with their interests at home. They spurned the internationalist pleas of President Woodrow Wilson and refused to join the League of Nations. The United States turned its back on its own history as a nation of immigrants and rejected the appeals of many refugees fleeing Asia and Europe who were knocking on its doors. The disgust with having fought in the war to end all wars was so pervasive that Americans of every class and region were determined to withdraw from world affairs. Today, similar sentiments of alienation reverberate across the United States in the wake of two failed military interventions in Iraq and Afghanistan. The mood of retrenchment between the two world wars was reflected in hostility toward accepting a new wave of immigrants. The Quota Acts of 1921 and 1924 set strict limits on the number of foreigners allowed into the country. This kind of isolationist sentiment also suffused American trade policies. The United States decided to impose high tariffs on imports in a short-sighted attempt to keep out foreign products and encourage economic growth at home. Like other forms of protectionism, the measures had a pernicious impact, raising prices for American consumers and causing grave hardship for European exporters that lost access to the American market. In turn, European governments hiked their own tariffs in retaliation to exclude products from American farms and factories. America's nagging demands to collect war debts from its beleaguered allies and a clash over reparations from a defeated Germany fanned further resentment between Europe and the United States. America's isolationist phase persisted for two decades, despite a constant drumbeat of warnings about the dangers of neglecting the outside world. While America slept, the ominous rise of communism, fascism, Nazism, and Japanese militarism would soon pave the way toward another world war. And even as the world was collapsing around them, Americans told themselves it was simply none of their business to get involved again in conflicts abroad. Their aversion to any foreign involvement was so intense that President Franklin Delano Roosevelt chose to disavow any plans for international action. During the 1936 election campaign, Roosevelt promised to, quote, shun political commitments which might entangle us in foreign wars. And he told American voters that he would do everything in his power to isolate ourselves completely from war. He continued to repeat his vow that there would be no American boots on European soil, even as Hitler conquered ever greater swaths of territory across Europe. The painful effects of the Great Depression and the traumatic memories from the First World War hardened the resolves of many Americans who were convinced that they should work to improve their own miserable predicament at home before worrying about the outside world. This disengaged view was shared by the leadership of both parties in the U.S. Congress. It was also reinforced among the public at large by widespread reports that banks and arms manufacturers had racked up enormous profits by pushing America into World War I. Many Americans were determined not to be tricked ever again by the banks and the merchants of death into making such enormous personal sacrifices through foreign military interventions. The Neutrality Acts were passed into law by Congress and were designed to prevent American ships and citizens from becoming embroiled in outside conflicts unfolding in Europe and Asia. Even the Nazi declarations of war against Britain, France, and Poland did not generate sufficient alarm for the United States to intervene. It would take a brazen assault by Japan on U.S. naval ships at Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, and the imminent threat of Nazi domination across Europe to convince a majority of Americans that their country's own future was suddenly at stake. The isolationist cocoon was shattered once Americans realized that their safety and security could no longer be guaranteed by two vast oceans and weak neighbors. When the war ended in 1945, the United States recognized that an entirely different approach was necessary to prevent future catastrophes caused by the perpetual cycle of the balance and of power struggles that inevitably led to wars in Europe. As the world's new superpower, the United States could no longer remain aloof from the rest of the world and resolved to build a new order that would banish the ghosts of nationalism that had fomented so much military conflict in every European generation over the course of five centuries. The mirage of national isolationism that captivated Americans between the wars was replaced by the bold international idealism first enshrined in Wilson's 14-point plan for universal peace. His failed project came back to life when the United Nations was established to wide acclaim just months after the wars with Germany and Japan came to an end. The Bretton Woods Agreement in 1944, put into place even before the war ended, laid the foundations for a global economic recovery through the creation of the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and the precursor of what would become the World Trade Organization. The generosity of the Marshall Plan, launched in 1948, would soon help Europe rebuild from the ruins of war. A year later, NATO was created as a collective security alliance to defend Western democracies from the expansionist designs of the Soviet Union and its communist empire. There were other enlightened initiatives as well. A young US senator named J. William Fulbright, who would go on to a distinguished career as chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, took note of the huge war debts owed to the United States that could never be repaid except in foreign currency. He also saw how similar funds could be raised through the sale of surplus US military equipment. Why not use these idle resources to finance educational exchanges? Fulbright's bright idea spawned one of the most successful acts of international cooperation ever devised in bringing students to and from the United States and over 150 foreign countries. In the past 70 years, the Fulbright program has enabled more than 300,000 students to spend time studying abroad, learning languages, and acquiring an international perspective that has encouraged greater mutual understanding. Some three dozen former Fulbright scholars have become heads of national governments, and over 50 of them have won a Nobel Prize. The early post-war years transformed the United States into a far-sighted paragon of internationalism. Instead of America first and its self-absorbed view of the world, President Harry S. Truman vowed in a memorable 1947 speech that the United States would provide political, military, and economic assistance to all democratic nations under threat from authoritarian forces. The Truman Doctrine declared the United States would invest heavily to prevent Greece and Turkey from succumbing to communist subversion. It also foreshadowed the transformation of American national security policy from a fortress mentality into a forward-leaning expeditionary posture, with US soldiers poised to intervene in distant conflicts to combat the spread of communism and defend Pax Americana. America had learned its lessons from two world wars. There could be no escape by retreating from its international obligations. The American initiative to assume leadership of the liberal democratic order when so much of the rest of the world lay in ruins helped restore a sense of confidence in Western concepts of free markets, free speech, and free elections. It also mobilized the European allies and contained the spread of Soviet expansionism in Europe and the Middle East. Through four decades of the Cold War, the United States would maintain its costly alliance commitments on different continents because the country understood its own political and economic interests were at stake in upholding the free world. America is now so invested in its foreign relationships that retrenchment from the world, as proven in the 1930s, could produce disastrous consequences, far worse than the costs of sustained engagement. The success of Western democracy culminated with the collapse of the Berlin Wall in 1989, the peaceful dissolution of the Soviet Union and its communist empire. America emerged as a benign hegemon whose powers in the world were uncontested. The United States and its Western allies seized the unipolar moment to promote the expansion of NATO and the European Union to embrace new members in Central and Eastern Europe. More than ever before, the United States was able to spread the gospel of free market democracy through Europe, Asia, Latin America, and Africa. The number of democratic governments increased from 44 to 86 in the two decades prior to 2015, representing 40% of the world's population and nearly 70% of its wealth. But over the past decade, the liberal international order has lost its luster. The struggle to defeat radical jihadist terrorism since the 9/11 attacks led to unpopular wars in Iraq and Afghanistan that squandered much American blood and treasure. The 2008 financial crisis caused painful recessions in the United States and Europe and fueled the populist insurgencies against mainstream governing parties that seemed incapable of restoring jobs and growth. The political dysfunction in Washington, D.C. and other Western capitals sapped confidence in the democratic model. Illiberal and authoritarian styles of government attracted support as voters became more impatient for quick solutions to pressing social and economic problems. The promise of greater prosperity through the disintegration of national boundaries and protected markets faded as globalization expanded the inequality gap between rich and poor. Many people in the West saw their living standards decline, even as greater wealth was concentrated in the pockets of the 1% elites. Instead of making everybody better off, the forces of globalization that brought nearly 3 billion people, the populations of China, India, and the former Soviet Empire, into the world economy had caused massive disruptions. As a result, the disillusionment among many working class people in both the United States and Europe has caused them to rebel against the ruling establishments and turn toward populist insurgents who promise them greater control over their lives. Donald Trump's rise to power behind the momentum of a new wave of nationalism bears an eerie similarity to the isolationist era that prevailed between the two world wars. There is growing protectionist sentiment in reaction to widespread economic insecurity, particularly among the Tea Party movement and blue-collar workers who have seen their factory jobs move to Mexico or to China. There is a surge of xenophobia reflected in calls for higher walls to keep out foreign immigrants. There is an expanding network of state surveillance driven by security obsessions about hidden dangers from terrorists who may be hiding in our midst. And there is the perception of corruption and cronyism among professional politicians, which has allowed Trump to exploit his status as a businessman untainted by past experience in government. Most of all, there is once again a strong desire in America to retreat from foreign economic and military engagements. Trump's vision suggests that in response to the wishes of the American public, the United States may soon pull back from defense and trade agreements, thus giving Russia and China unfettered control over their own neighborhoods. Exhausted by the forever wars in the Middle East and yearning to build a more equitable society at home, Americans seem eager to indulge in another phase of retrenchment. Indeed, this mood is reflected in opinion polls that show American isolationist sentiment is higher today than at any time in the past 50 years. The Pew survey, which has been measuring US public opinion since 1964, has concluded that public support for an active American foreign policy has never been so low. A 2013 survey found that the share of Americans who believe the United States should mind its own business internationally and let other countries get along the best they can on their own has reached a record high of 52%. In previous polls taken every year over four decades, that figure ranged between 20 and 40%. Another metric has confirmed the sharp rise in isolationist attitudes. When asked if they think, if they agreed with the statement that the United States should not think so much in terms of, should not so much in international, think in international terms, but concentrate more on our own national problems, an unprecedented level of 80% said they did. In addition, the inquiry showed record numbers of Americans now believe their country is less important and less powerful as a world leader than it was a decade earlier. A striking 70% of Americans also believe the United States is less respected abroad than it has been in the past. For seven decades, the United States has provided the security umbrella under which the liberal international system has flourished. But today, the United States is more inward-looking than at any time since World War II. While Barack Obama sought to recalibrate America's role abroad by encouraging allies to take greater responsibility for their own security, President Trump now promises to pursue transactional bargains. He wants the United States to become a mercenary power, protecting only those countries willing to pay for this protection so that he can concentrate on making America great again at home. The hard lessons learned throughout history suggest the best way for the United States to care for its own interests is by investing in the security of its allies. American primacy in the world has been assured by its outward projection of power in managing the international order, ensuring the rule of law through institutions like the UN, IMF, WTO, and World Bank. But now, through a combination of neglect, mismanagement, and dwindling American support, these pillars are crumbling. The disregard the United States has shown toward these institutions has eroded their power and influence. Too often, America has acted in a unilateral manner only selectively respected the rules of the international order that it once vowed to preserve. It invaded Iraq under a dubious legal mandate that has been cited by Russia as justification for its own aggressive actions in Ukraine. The U.S. Congress has refused to ratify the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, as well as other multilateral treaties. The overthrow of Libya's dictator Muammar al-Qaddafi in 2011 was carried out without a clear international mandate. And while criticizing Russia and Syria for indiscriminate bombing of civilians in Syria, the United States continues to support Saudi Arabia in pursuing its own bloody bombing campaign in Yemen. Such inconsistencies have left the United States vulnerable to charges of hypocrisy by Putin and other critics who claim the United States only respects international law when it serves America's strategic purposes. While many Americans, Trump included, would reject such criticism, it is important to realize that when the United States applies only selective support for international laws and treaties that provide the foundation for the liberal democratic order, it provides an excuse for Russia and other potential foes to follow the same course of action. In his famous book, The Arrogance of Power, Senator Fulbright argued that scrupulous respect by the United States for the reign of international law was vital to maintain peace and security in a liberal democratic order. Otherwise, that system can quickly unravel. Quote, it provides us with stability and order and with a means of predicting the behavior of those with whom we have reciprocal legal obligations, Fulbright wrote. When we violate the law ourselves, whatever short-term advantage may be gained, we are obviously encouraging others to violate the law. We thus encourage disorder and instability and thereby do incalculable damage to our own long-term interests. When President Trump says he intends to tear up trade agreements and walk away from American pledges under the Paris Climate Change Pact or the Iran Nuclear Accord, he thus provides ammunition for our enemies to renege on laws and conventions designed to restrain their own transgressions. Trump says he says he feels obliged to renounce America's obligations because the government was duped into signing bad deals under the feckless or naive leadership of its predecessors. That rationale has been used time and again by populist and right-wing demagogues seeking to justify behavior that breaks international law. D.W. Brogan, in his famous 1952 essay titled The Illusion of American Omnipotence, observed that America First policies are often rooted in the illusion that any situation which distresses or endangers the United States can only exist because some Americans have been fools or naive. The world stands at a hinge moment in history. The post-Cold War order is coming to an end. Pax Americana, that managed global security and world trade for 70 years, is weakening. The era of unipolar American dominance has passed, but nobody can be sure what will emerge in its place. Will Russia assert greater control over its neighbors and project new influence in the Middle East, even though its economy is decaying and its population rapidly shrinking? Will China and India fulfill their ambitions to become new superpowers, even though they confront volatile social and economic tensions at home? In the West, disenchantment with the ruling class and a growing chasm between rich and poor threaten to destabilize our democracies. Populist movements built on the myopia of economic nationalism, which has caused so many wars and other disasters in world history, are now resurgent in the United States and Europe. These grassroots uprisings have polarized societies on both sides of the Atlantic, creating hostile camps that espouse radically different philosophies about how our citizens should be governed. In the United States, where Hillary Clinton won 3 million more votes in the presidential election than Donald Trump, Democrats believe the Electoral College system disavowed the popular choice for the second time in less than 2 decades and ushered into power somebody they view as an illegitimate president. In Europe, the revival of populist nationalism has inflamed grievances toward a European Union seen as controlled by an elite class of unelected officials who ignore the will of the people. These internal battles may damage the liberal democratic order and transatlantic unity at a time when Western leaders confront global challenges that require collective action as never before. Today, many Europeans fear an absence of strong American leadership will unleash the demons of nationalism that have caused so much havoc on their continent and in the world. Liberal democracies can wither and die quickly, with disastrous consequences if the wrong choices are made in just 2 or 3 elections. Whether catastrophes of this kind witnessed in the previous century will occur again may depend on a potentially dangerous return to a transactional system of balance of power politics. Will the governments of Europe and the United States look inward, as many voters now seem to desire, or will they realize their national interests are best served by participating in a liberal democratic order that shares common goals and values? In a fractured Europe and a divided America, the political struggle over this fateful choice will determine the road to peace or calamity over the course of the next century.
Thank you very much. The moment you ended, behind me somebody said, "Wow." And that was a
thank God it's over.
The richness and the density of the image that you created here for us is of course quite stunning, and it tells us what times we are living. I'm especially thankful that you basically put this isolationist moment, this America First moment, into historic perspective. You described and explained how its roots, its cultural and political roots, go way back at least to the 1920s, if not even further back than this. Based on this, and based on the truism that today isolationism gets punished quicker than it used to, quicker certainly than in the 1920s, how long do you think can the America First moment last this time around?
Well, I like to say that national symbol of the United States should not be the bald eagle, but rather a pendulum that swings back and forth. And Mark Twain, the quote is attributed to him anyway, said that history may not repeat itself, but it does rhyme. And I think this is what is so eerily reminiscent of that period in the 20s and 30s when we made the wrong choice, and we pursued this isolationist America First moment. My hope is that very soon in the Trump administration that there will be sensible voices in positions of influence who make it clear that this is unsustainable. America First simply can't work for some of the reasons I outlined, whether it's international trade or international security. And the risk is that too much damage gets done along the way. I think if there is a terrorist attack in the United States, and that is exploited, that fears are exploited, and that could be used to submerge the free press, a free judiciary, I think this would be one of the most damaging effects on our democracy.
You just mentioned the more reasonable voices, and that you had hoped that they would prevail, or at least, you know, prevent the worst things from happening. Now, there, you know, 5 weeks into this presidency, there are these two camps, essentially. The ones that say, oh my God, this is the worst thing ever, this is going to get even worse, and, you know, how can we possibly survive the next 4 years? And then there are those, at least in the foreign policy field, who say, well, if you look carefully, you will detect that essentially on most foreign policy issues, you know, this administration has kind of gotten back to where traditional American raison d'etat lies. You know, it has tried to reassure the Europeans, admittedly with a few, you know, with a higher price tag, but the right messages have come out. You know, on Russia, Trump made a U-turn, essentially. On the one China policy, he made a U-turn back to what traditional American foreign policy was like. So that's the other camp that says reason already does prevail. So where do you stand in this, in these, you know, when it comes to these two camps? And do you see, you know, is some of this panic that you can, that you also describe, I think, in your book on behalf of the Europeans, is that overdone? You know, will these voices prevail, or is pessimism the mode that we should adopt?
Well, I think we could only hope for the best and plan for the worst. But I think the optimistic scenario is that Trump is an entertainer. And he uses rhetoric to shock people, as he did on his television shows. And if that is a way of, let's say, getting the attention of the allies to spend more on defense, then good, he's accomplishing a worthwhile goal. But in terms of turning the back on our back on our alliances, our friends, why pick a fight with some of your closest allies, Mexico and Germany? Totally unnecessary. And it preoccupies then the voices of reason within the government, such as James Mattis, the defense secretary, or H.R. McMaster, who has an excellent reputation, has just become national security advisor. Whether these people are sufficiently endowed with power to convince the president not to go down this reckless path. I think 5 weeks into the administration, it's too early to tell. But we can only hope that that their voices will win the battle for power. But right now we see several different power centers. It's interesting, you may have read about how Trump is criticizing all these leaks that are coming out. Well, the reason there are so many leaks, particularly out of the White House, is there are probably five power centers, and they're all leaking against each other, and this often happens. I mean, for a journalist, it's always, you always go to the guy who has a vendetta against the other one. So it's a good way of developing sources and coming up with some interesting stories.
You just said that hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. Now, for this book, you have traveled Europe extensively. You've been to various countries, to all kinds of capitals, lots of interlocutors from all walks of life and political affiliations. What's your sense of how the Europeans prepare for this and what their reaction to this is? Is there some sort of cohesiveness in this, or is it, you know, just all over the place?
Well, I think some crises are reaching the breaking point sooner than others. I think my most recent trip to Greece convinced me that this country is about to explode again, they have reached such a level of hopelessness in terms of their shrinking living standards. You have a vast rise in suicide rates. 30% of the economy has shrunk by nearly one-third in the last few years. You have people who have gone from middle-class levels to living on the streets. So that's one thing. Potential banking crisis in Italy and the political chaos there is also a troubling thing. Spain is looking a little better, but I think the critical question in the weeks and months to come will be what happens in France. If we get a pro-European voice like Emmanuel Macron as president, that would be an encouraging sign and a hope that this will reverse the populist trend. But he will still have difficulties putting his program into action because he doesn't have much of a political party behind him.
So are the Europeans mentally prepared for the geopolitical shock that they might be in for if Trump turns out to be the worst case scenario?
I don't think they are, because and I don't think it's possible, because there will be surprises along the way. I think what's most troubling about this, and when I was doing the reporting, is that, and why I titled the book Fractured Continent, is that despite all the efforts toward a more integrated and cohesive European Union, the perceptions of problems in all these different capitals is radically different everywhere, and that it's the multitude of crises compounding in such a way that makes these problems so difficult to resolve. Because you may think that, whether it's applying sanctions against Russia in order to expedite a solution to the Ukraine crisis may help. But in the meantime, you have others who are, countries are saying, no, we've got a youth, a lost generation of people unemployed who are about to go out on the streets and bring down the government. So I think these various crises building into a perfect storm, which worries me the most.
So the Europeans are not prepared for it? And you even say that it's impossible to be prepared for it. And yet at the same time, the one anchor that keeps it all together might actually go away or be lifted and disappear. So,
or even provoke, we could see the IMF has warned that Trump's policies would plunge the world into a deep depression. And I think that there's a lot of legitimacy behind that view.
So based on all of this, what will the title of your next book be?
Let's see. I don't know. Let's say The Sunrise After the Storm. Something like that.
One final question I want to ask before we open it to the audience is, you quoted from Trump's 2000 book, I think, where he said that essentially European conflicts are not worth American lives. Are they worth American lives?
Well, I think when we're standing up for the values that we hold dear, it is, yes. And there are things worth fighting for. And I think this is why America has attracted so much admiration around the world. What we did in World War II in particular is really the basis for the support and admiration that America elicits around the world. So I think there's, Trump is going around saying, we don't win wars anymore, we only lose them. Well, that's sending a very negative message to the men and women who are serving in uniform and who are putting their lives on the line in a lot of hopeless situations, whether it be Iraq, Afghanistan, or elsewhere, that they're trying to do their job as best they can, but they've been put in an impossible situation by irresponsible politicians.
That doesn't sound like an awful lot of trust that the current administration will put them where they reasonably should be.
Well, again, I'm hoping that the voices of reason will prevail.
All right. The voices of reason, that means you. So I have a couple of hands already. Should we collect or should we take one after the other? How do you prefer it? One after the other. All right, very good. I think there's one right there in the door frame. We have one microphone. Please introduce yourself and make that one question, please.
Good evening. My name is Ralf Gütersloh, and if I look at all the plans of the Trump administration, I was wondering who's going to end up paying for that. And I don't mean politically, but financially. The American people, China, the countries in the Middle East, Western Europe, and any ideas who's going to pay for everything that's on the Trump agenda?
That's a clear question.
Yeah, well, it's a very timely question, and I think after he will announce tonight in his first address to both houses of Congress that he wants to raise the defense budget by 54%,
or by 10%, $54 billion, that, and he will pay for this by reducing expenses or spending in other areas, such as social welfare. This is a, and but he still doesn't want to touch Social Security or Medicaid, and this is what the Republican leadership in Congress wants to do. So I think we already have signs of a growing conflict between Trump and the leaders of the Republican Congress, because this is in this situation, the Republicans realize they have no way of blaming somebody else. They may try to blame Obama and the legacy they've inherited, but they now have control over not just the U.S. Congress and the White House, but also so many state legislatures and state governments. So I think this is, they have no excuse but to blame their own poor policies. And this is what is going to, how you go about paying for this and satisfy the demands of the Tea Party rebels who support so much of the Republican agenda, who want government to be shrunk, is going to be a very difficult dilemma for both Trump and Paul Ryan, Speaker of the House, to resolve.
We have a question in the third row here.
Leslie Calder is my name. I was the Financial Times correspondent in Berlin for many years and in Eastern Europe. Even if Trump would be tamed, however, what do we do about the problem of the 28% of the electorate who elected him and who have been neglected by how many administrations? Maybe four consecutive American administrations have forgotten these people, Republican and Democrat. How is this problem going to be solved? Because this is the basis. This is what's feeding populism in America.
Now we're getting to the root causes.
Right. I think the only reasonable solution is to invest more in education. Now, we're not going to solve the problem for, let's say, the 50-year-old blue-collar white male who lost his factory job, which was, let's say, when General Motors had a factory in Michigan and he was getting paid $70,000, $80,000 a year. Now he's left with nothing. I think the most we can do is try to help those people cope at their stage in life as best they can. But at least for the younger generation, I think the we need to somehow use the skills and assets of our greatest universities and our the other great schools in the United States to expand their capability of reaching a greater part of the population, because we didn't get into this in the discussion, but the quality of education in the United States is really lopsided. You have some of the greatest institutions in the entire world that attract the world's best and brightest to go study there, and then you also have a dysfunctional public schooling system. And how we resolve that, I think, is going to be an important factor in terms of social peace as well as training for the future.
Who wants to go next? Right here, fourth row.
I'm Dorothea Schneider, and I'm happy to be here at the Academy as a fellow's fellow this semester. I have a question about the alternative vision. The Trump administration and its popular support has formulated its program very much as a domestic drama. The domestic drama is now played out in an international stage, of course. The American left, not just the group with the last name Sanders, but a lot of voters that voted for Hillary Clinton, is only now emerging as an alternative to a lot of people who are having second thoughts, and to the big center of American foreign policy that seems to have evaporated in the past 2 or 3 months. Do you have any comments on what you see as an emerging alternative, not necessarily the old internationalist vision, but a vision that gives credence to the popular discontent with an internationalist free trade agenda?
Well, I think I would focus, first of all, on the younger generation. It was very disappointing, and I think there's a lot of regret being expressed now among young people who failed to turn out because they were unenthusiastic about Hillary Clinton's candidacy. Now, it's true that that Hillary does not have the charisma that her husband did. She's not a very good candidate. I think she would have made a terrific president because of her intelligence and sagacity and wisdom. But it's true that she, in this day and age, in the media-centric world that we live in, she did not run an effective campaign. But I think, again, I keep coming back to the younger generation. It was very disappointing that, on the one hand, it looked like we were on an upswing. They were Obama's candidacy in 2008 helped bring many more young people of all races into the political system. Then they sort of just disappeared. Maybe that's part of the millennial generation. But I think that has got to be the hope for the future. And I'm encouraged by the fact that a lot of them are looking at the Trump administration and realizing that this is what the world we are going to inherit. It's not, you know, Donald Trump's 70 years old, he may not care about it. And I recall the words of George Bernard Shaw saying, old men are dangerous because they don't care what will happen to the world after they're gone. But young people should definitely care, and that's all the more reason for them to get inspired, whether or not it's behind a particular candidate like Bernie Sanders or somebody else. But I'm hoping that the next election and certainly the next presidential election that that the younger generation gets involved, both in Europe and the United States.
We have, unfortunately, limited time, but the gentleman with the glasses all the way there in the corner, please. And then perhaps Paul Geyer, we take your question in as well, and then we do quick answers to this, and then I have a final question as well. Please.
Thank you. My name is Paul Custer, and I'm founder of an international NGO, Red Noses, Clowns in Hospitals. And one of the questions I'm asked the most by people who are concerned is who stands to gain from this movement, which is spearheaded by Steve Bannon and the Tea Party movement? In your opinion, who really stands behind if this all goes through and this nationalist movement and the country's all split and there's no international coalitions? Who are going to be the winners?
Okay, we take Paul Geyer's question in as well, and then back to Bill.
I'm Paul Geyer. I'm a professor of philosophy at Brown University and the Daimler Fellow this semester. And my question is, apropos of your last comments, is that it seems, given how narrow Trump's victory actually was, it's easy to imagine a scenario under which some increased involvement of younger people and so on could easily turn things around at the presidential level. But can you imagine any scenario under which there can be a progressive recontrol of Congress and of the states throughout the country because of the peculiarities of our electoral system? That seems way harder to imagine.
So right. First question, who stands to gain?
Right, well, I think what we're seeing, the amazing thing, despite his rhetoric in the campaign, which he attracted blue-collar, alienated Americans, he seems to be following the path of hiring the 1% for a lot of the key positions. Steve Mnuchin, the Treasury Secretary, another graduate of Goldman Sachs, Bannon himself, despite his right-wing incendiary rhetoric, is also working for Goldman Sachs. And so, and the banks seem to be rubbing their hands with glee, thinking that if he dismantles the Dodd-Frank restrictions, this is going to open up their profit possibilities even more. So I think that you look at Trump himself as being, you know, part of the 1%. So far, a lot of the people that he seems to be putting in place are those that may have signed on to his rhetoric about helping the blue-collar middle class, but they're in it pretty much for themselves. So I think that the you're going to see more and more, and I hope this gets attention in the press coverage and in public opinion, because this is going to be, this could be the source of a popular rebellion against Trump if they start to see that the promises that he would help them are actually being betrayed because of he's working with the rich upper class more than ever. As far as the second point, you know, I think in terms of the outlook for Congress, it's because of the gerrymandering that was done over the past, well, the last couple of censuses, that the Republicans have been able to solidify their control over Congress. But I don't rule out a major rebellion against the sitting congressmen, including the Republicans who have such vast control over a lot of counties, if these desires are not met on the part of their constituents. You know, already you see the outlines of a possible concern that things could spin out of control. I was recently at the Munich Security Conference and talked with a number of Republicans who were there, and they're very nervous about Trump. They feel that he holds no sense of loyalty to the Republican Party or the congressional leadership, and that they feel if his policies cause a sharp downturn in the economy or a global recession, they will get blown away in the midterm elections just by the state of the economy. And as you well know, the voters tend to vote in turn with their pocketbooks. And if these people who voted for Republicans in Congress and for Trump feel betrayed, then they're likely to look for other alternatives. So that's one solution. But it's a very volatile electorate, as we see, not just in the United States, but all over Europe. Opinion polls are very untrustworthy. We saw it in Brexit. We're seeing it in France. Nobody can really call the election about Marine Le Pen, even though polls show that she won't get much more than 40% in the second round. But that could prove to be wrong.
Let me abuse my privilege as of being the moderator for two very quick concluding questions. On that last point that Paul Geyer made, essentially that's the question about the self-healing capacity of the U.S. system, which is, you know, this one thing that every student of political science learns. The first thing basically in the first year is that there are these famous, you know, pendulum swinging back forces in the U.S. system, the checks and balances. Yes, the system can go wrong, but eventually it will heal itself. Do you see that structural damage can be inflicted or has already been inflicted to the self-healing powers, or is it still intact and it's just a question of time until the pendulum indeed swings back?
Well, I think if you look at Trump's attacks on the press and on the judiciary, I think there are signs that it's backfiring on him. I don't think the media will be cowed into submission about covering his, you know, contradictions, put a kind word on it. And that also, I was heartened to see that even his nominee for the Supreme Court, Neil Gorsuch, spoke out and said any intimidation of the judiciary is not acceptable. So if the judges themselves, even those appointed by Republican leaders, can stand up and defend these values, I think that's what's key to our institutions. But I'm always, whenever I come to the American Academy, I always recall the words of Fritz Stern, who was a trustee here and an eminent scholar of Germany. And when I first came to Germany as a correspondent for the Washington Post, he was one of the first people I sought out as to give me some advice. And toward the end of his life, I asked Fritz, you know, in all your years of studying Germany and European history, you know, what was it that that struck you, surprised you the most about him? And he said it was how quickly things can turn in a democracy. He said he carried with him all his life the fact that 4 months after coming to power, Hitler and the Nazis had locked up the institutions. 4 months, he said. It was just striking. And he says, and that's what worried him about the rise of Trump, that he said, his adopted homeland, if the United States, which seems to be such a sound and well-structured democracy, would go through that, it would be unbearable. So it's a very cautionary signal from one of the great historians of our time and, you know, one of the great inspirations of the Academy.
I cannot spare you one final word on Germany and all of this. We haven't talked about Germany a lot, which is unusual these days in this town, where it's really all about the question of what do we need to do? What's the responsibility of this new Germany? And you've described the rather abysmal state of the Europeans as such, the fractured continent, and then also the risk of losing the transatlantic alliance. What's Germany's task in all of this? How would you describe it?
Well, this is the subject of another book or another lecture, but I think what we will see in the next months and years to come is that Germany will be put in an extremely difficult and important situation. What happens here could affect the entire course of Europe and certainly the relationship with the United States. I think if Trump follows through on his challenges to Germany, both in terms of defense spending, which will raise all sorts of dilemmas, how quickly can Germany get, if it tried to reach the 2% level, that would be another 30 or 40 billion euros in defense spending, which would shock a lot of the neighbors and not have much support at home. And if he attacks Germany's trade surplus, as he's threatened to do, then this could jeopardize Germany's export business. So I think Germany is going to be very much in the focus of other European leaders and the United States in the years and months to come. So the decisions that are taken here will have a profound impact. And it's and as you're entering an election period that will, as we know, election campaigns can be very volatile, particularly if you have outside forces like Russian bots and computers intervening. The prospect of a fractured Bundestag with as many as six parties represented, it's going to be very decisive. But I think Berlin is going to be a fascinating place in the months to come.
May we all live in interesting times. Thank you very much, Phil.
Yep. Thanks.